half an hour to shower, put on my face, put it all together, top up with a milk tea, and out the door. That's my morning routine. Could take less time. Not for butterfly children, nor for the mother getting her autistic child ready for his care center. It's a full working day from 9 to 4 for trainers and trainees. That's up to 12 kids and youngsters daily. Here in Iran Autism Association, we are faced with medium to severe autism, but hope prevails. Repetition, habit, belief is the order of the effort's mantra to improve trainees' conditions. There's plenty to be said on the matter of ASD and EB and obstacles they meet along the way, namely sanctions. So stay with me, Leila Faramerzi, on Iran Today. Autism is a neurological disorder, usually graded in severity along a spectrum, ASD. It causes problems with thinking, feeling, language, and relating to others. And so, medications prescribed serve as a means of chemical restraint rather than having a legitimate therapeutic purpose. That is to say, kids or sufferers are treated for conditions often associated with autism, including anxiety, hyperactivity, and aggression. We are talking anything from sleep disorders to violent meltdowns. The 7-year-old Iran Autism Association started its program for severe cases 6 months ago. Girls are in mind too, but resources are still limited and demand on the part of families has been higher for boys to receive care outside home. I got to talk to all sorts of professionals at either center of the association, namely athletic young trainers. It was touching to see them put their energy to use in childcare with a complication. Here's an expert opinion by Mr. Tavakkoli.
Medication as part of the treatment for autism can manage some of the symptoms. We provide occupational therapy for sensory, motor, and cognitive functions, speech therapy, behavioral therapy, and also music and art therapies such as painting with watercolor and so on for children so they can acquire skills by the age of 7, enter the education and school process, and learn reading and writing skills. Our interventions will help the children to easily perform simple and repetitive tasks after a certain age.
Sensory issues autistic people have dysregulate them further, which makes training all that much more sensitive. Say if a caregiver yells at a child in an effort to rein in behavior, it's likely to have the opposite effect. We met Mr. Fallah, a lead trainer, as he was working hands-on. His background is sports.
Every child is different. One can reach a particular level in 1 month, another might take a year. If you consider 10,000 autistic children, every single one of them needs their own special care. It's not like one guideline applies to all. That's what makes things more challenging. The coach's decisions at the moment matter. The decision made at the moment could be a right or a wrong one.
In this episode, I'm telling of how sanctions have hampered the inflow of medical supplies and pharmaceutical raw materials to this country. Also, of how they've helped domestic corruption further degrade the Iranian economy, which means families can't readily buy medical supplies, even if available. Autism and the Iranian Autism Association are our case study of the day. A case study of deprivation and survival by self-help and domestic help. But autism is not the only condition at stake. Ms. Javadi is manager of the association's health unit. She shares her medical outlook with us.
The families are procuring the medications by any means, although the economic problems and the massive inflation in their prices have created challenges for accessing the medicines. Currently, families are facing problems in getting their hands on medicines used for seizures, including Depakote and so on. Medicines prescribed for hyperactive children like Ritalin are among those the families report to have become hard to find or rising so much in price. For example, a pack of Ritalin, which used to be sold for 45,000 tomans is now 125,000. This rise in price for a medication that the child is constantly using is too much.
EB, epidermolysis bullosa, is a rare hereditary disease or condition. It usually manifests in infancy or early childhood with very fragile skin that develops blisters or wounds like third-degree burns. There is no cure, but that means the flow of medical equipment for pain relief and blister control must never stop. With age, however, symptoms of mild forms of the disease or condition, rather, can improve. Our skin is our protective cover. Imagine being uncomfortable in your own skin 24/7, or every hard, flat surface being a hazard if you bump into it to chap your skin. I got to talk to Mr. Golpayagani for a former program on EB. He is executive director of EB Home for Butterfly Children.
The U.S. claims that food and medications are not subject to sanctions. As the father of an EB patient, as well as 750 other EB patients, I can tell you that it is not so in practice. I am feeling the sanctions. I am feeling the sanctions, for example, in dressing here for EB patients.
EB patients or butterfly children live with constant pain and stress, with levels varying, of course. They often require extensive bandaging from head to toe and are at risk of malnutrition and other problems. Bathing and wound management can take 3 to 5 hours at a time. We know what will happen if they don't bandage up. Blistering and flaking actually can occur mechanically as the sufferer is just sitting down to force out a chat. The most painful disease you've ever heard of. That's how dermatologists, US dermatologists, have described EB. That's a genetic mutation that occurs in every one in 30,000 to 50,000 live births globally. But each butterfly suffers a pain enough for the whole of humanity and can't be overlooked. As long as there's life, it requires relief. EB patients are referred to as butterfly children because of the delicacy and fragility of their skin, which can grow over. Relief is what they seek, as do their families. The only relatively real relief is through specialized foam dressings that reduce and protect blisters. The best are made by the Swedish pharmaceutical company Mölnlycke. For Iran's 800 to 1,200 EB sufferers, accessing the supplies became close to impossible since the 2018 US pullout from the JCPOA and crippling sanctions that ensued. But then in May 2020, UNICEF made a surprise announcement that a German-financed shipment of wound dressings from the Swedish company had been procured by the UN and shipped to Iran. The shipment, which weighs just under 6 metric tons, was to be a one-time shipment, but it came at a welcome time given corona-inflicted travel restrictions which stopped respite in the form of wound dressings and bandages coming in with travelers. To see how far our kids of today's focus have come, let's go back to the Autism Association. US sanctions and restrictions on the export of drugs and medical equipment to Iran have shortened the breadth of all patients suffering from special diseases and conditions such as cancer, hemophilia, epilepsy, and thalassemia. Mr. Mohammadi is on the Iran Autism Association Board of Directors, and he is himself father to an autistic son.
The U.S. claims that medications aren't subject to sanctions, but in practice they are, as evidenced by the pharmaceutical companies who are saying they're having problems importing medicine. The importers and producers are facing problems bringing in raw materials. They're also concerned with foreign currency exchange rates. We might suddenly realize there's a drug that plays a key role in treating autism, although some might object, arguing that there's no cure for autism. But children are using medications, they need to improve their attention and concentration. They need to calm down as they're mostly hyperactive and are restless. This means that we need medicines used for managing other symptoms for autistic children, which are quite expensive.
Thing is, Mr. Mohammadi thinks it's paramount to import drugs for quality. That's contrary to our lady doctor's opinion. But they agree on one thing, that it matters which company, Iranian or otherwise, the kids buy from.
You see, for example, the Depakine pills that are produced overseas are way better in terms of quality compared to their domestic counterparts, both in terms of controlling restlessness and lack of attention and focus. On the other hand, we are experiencing different effects from the same medicine which is produced by two companies. For example, the risperidone, which is being produced inside the country, especially by the Supon pharmaceutical company, varies in its effectiveness. I've seen that in the case of my own child, who responded very well to risperidone made by Supon, but not to that of Dr. Arbady's company. We never realize why this difference exists.
You see, Iranian pharmaceutical companies are also working very hard. But what's important to us is the accessibility of the medications for the families. We don't want a family of a child who's displaying behavioral problems all day long to be unable to buy the medication they need in their own city. We don't want them to have to travel long distances to Tehran or its nearby cities just to purchase the drugs. This is heartbreaking. It would be very helpful if the pharmaceutical companies can meet the minimum needs of the families and distribute their products across the country.
Although less than before, there's still plenty of vitamins and ordinary drugs in the market, but the US is making its utmost attempts to prevent Iran from purchasing vital medicine and necessities for, say, cancer patients. Time for a short break. We'll be back in no time. Helping kids with debilitating conditions means going as far as preparing them for a measure of independence in society and holding down a job even. It may sound ambitious looking at Iran's unemployment rate of around 10% and more, but then looking at paintings by some autistic individuals, it doesn't seem too ambitious after all, except that shortages can get in the way of progress. Shortages with medicine and facilities, say.
Autistic children are working in production lines everywhere. You can see that in our country too. Some are answering the phone, doing simple tasks such as typing. They are not distracted while they work. Or they can be presenters in a place like a museum, showing the visitors around. Because that's a repetitive task and they might have to do it 20-30 times a day. This is a simple task for which autistic children can be easily trained to do. They are usually quite punctual, don't talk on their phones or get distracted by their cell phones like other people, and are generally more organized in their jobs, because they are doing the jobs based on their specific talents.
I asked how that would help a society with less than satisfactory employment levels for people unafflicted even.
When we talk about employment for autistic children, some might say there are many people unemployed in Iran, let alone autistic ones. But it's not a matter of who's normal. These children need supportive regulations, and those laws have been written for them. The laws have been enacted by the parliament and communicated to businesses that can use these children as their workforce with special conditions. Part of their salaries are paid by governmental organizations, so they can be employed. We can't assume that all rights are ours, and we are the only ones entitled to go on the streets, have a walk in the park, visit amusement parks, and go to cinemas. Just because we are healthy and don't suffer from any disability, an autistic child has the right to vote. They and their fathers are paying taxes. They are also paying municipal taxes.
Plenty more to see and hear. But first, a quick media review to see what other news outlets have to say. Here it is. In talking of US sanctions, naturally expectations will be directed at the US's first man. Common Dreams reads, to end collective and cruel punishment, Biden must go further on sanctions relief. The devastation and suffering unleashed on Venezuelans and Iranians as a result of US maximum pressure sanctions has been unfathomable. Iranians continue to suffer from the consequences of maximum pressure sanctions that have devastated the economy, paralyzing the poor and pushing the middle class into poverty. According to the Wall Street Journal, economic sanctions led to an upsurge in unemployment and a depreciation in Iran's currency, the rial, by 80% against the dollar. The rising inflation in Iran, accompanied by dangerous rhetoric from US officials, makes it increasingly difficult for Iran to import essential medicine and medical equipment. A report from Human Rights Watch found that unilateral sanctions disproportionately impact Iranians with rare medical conditions, such as epilepsy, leukemia, and those suffering with chronic eye injuries from exposure to chemical weapons used during the Iran-Iraq War. The report further notes that women have suffered severe complications after cesarean section performed under non-standard anesthesia, the only anesthesia available due to sanctions. Now, Iran's health sector may have suffered US sanctions, but it's also had achievements, according to Iran's UN representative. Tasnim News reads, UN endangers Iranian nation's health towards political goals, says the envoy. Iran's permanent envoy to the United Nations identifies the United States' illegal and inhumane sanctions against the country as a means of jeopardizing the health of the Iranian people in pursuit of political purposes. Majid Takht-Ravanchi, that is, made the statements at the UN General Assembly's high-level meeting on AIDS. He spoke on Iran's accomplishments in the area of HIV-positive patients' health and those who are affected by the phenomena. The official noted how Iranian scientists had managed to enable prevention of the disease's transfer from affected mothers to their children and also contain the disease's adverse effects. Despite the notable progress, Iran is still suffering from the sanctions that prevent its access to medical products, technology, and cooperation with the international financial institutions, he said. Now, what's to be done when autism combines with corona? Irna says adults with autism in Iran vaccinated against COVID-19. According to Irna, Iran Autism Association reported in its website that a group of autistic adults over 18 years old were vaccinated against the coronavirus disease, getting their second dose of the vaccine. People with autism are more likely to be affected by different pandemic diseases. In addition, quarantine is much harder for them due to the complicated conditions with which these people are entangled. As a result, their parents and supporters prefer to keep them at home despite all difficulties. Many of these people need ongoing rehabilitation. COVID-19 disrupts this routine. The closure of schools, the lack of classes, and rehabilitation sessions for these people have all caused many problems, like exacerbation of nervous symptoms and behaviors that have made quarantine much more difficult for them in case they get affected with the virus. Therefore, thanks to the efforts made by the Iran Autism Association in collaboration with Atiya Hospital and the Ministry of Health, Treatment and Medical Education, adults over 18 years old received their corona vaccines in three groups. That would be it for this section, but do stay with us. In charges and parents are looking to the greater government, including the legislature, for more help, as well as to their own capabilities. 5-6 years ago, some parents had declared they wanted to leave Iran for countries with nursing homes for autistic people. That's an astronomically expensive option with slim chances of acquiring foreign residency.
We engaged in talks with the parliament, especially with the health commission. They helped us sign into law a national autism document, which we drafted. The document was prepared by Iran's Autism Forum scientific experts, but had been stalled for years in the parliament. That's why we started our work and asked again. They helped us eventually, but the national autism document, with all the aspects considered for it, became a two-page document dubbed the National Autism Program, which was announced and signed by three ministers whose organizations are known as being in charge of autism.
Others said they were willing to work together and help establish a nursing home in Iran. Dr. Mormeni in Sweden volunteered. And presently, many parents are involved and extend their services beyond their own suffering to help train classrooms full of kids. We have a case right here, predominantly active even after losing her own child, perhaps because of losing her own child to an indirect autism-related accident.
I don't know. These are some matters that go back to the human beings themselves to decide what they are going to do now that they are living in this world. What was their purpose for being born? If they are here to make themselves useful and take steps to help their peers, they need to understand that this is something that could happen to them too. I think we should want something for others that we want for ourselves. We need to take this step.
In 2019, some 62 centers offering treatment and rehabilitation services to autistic patients were operating under the Medical Sciences University's supervision nationwide, which mostly offer services to those financially struggling patients, a supportive package including occupational therapy, speech therapy, behavioral interventions, and counseling services have been scheduled to be provided to those children and their families by the aforesaid centers. Tehran Times quoted the Health Ministry's head of the Department for Transplantation and Treatment of Diseases at the time, saying his ministry had doubled the subsidies allocated to 4,000 autistic patients under the welfare organization's coverage, granting 10 million rials per patient. For an update, I refer to authority.
Well, the costs are very high based on our average. If a family wants to continue the child's behavioral therapy, it needs to pay at least 5 million tomans per month. This figure is too much for the families, given that many of them aren't covered by any insurance or services, so their problems will grow by the day. Or take this, for example, that most autistic children need to be anesthetized to receive their routine dental checkups, and that anesthesia is too costly for the families.
A problem that definitely grows with age, as Mr. Tavakkoli reckons, is education and training.
They are growing up. They are teenagers and adults now. One of the problems we are facing is that we don't have high schools for these children. Most of the schools are secondary or early high school years. The second issue is that there aren't enough centers where they can learn professions. Children who have a moderate to good performance can learn professions and arts so they can enter society and be employed. Also, we don't have care centers for those who have weak performances. The number of those centers in the country could be fewer than your fingers.
It is estimated about 320,000 autistic individuals can be identified in Iran, approximately 35,000 of them being children under school age, that's up to 7 years of age. In the month that followed, Iran's welfare organization reportedly launched an online autism screening website for parents with children aged 2 to 5 years to refer to. Children found susceptible to autism were to be referred to the nearest welfare offices to confirm the disorder and receive subsequent rehabilitating services.
Our figures show there are about 30,000 autistic people in Iran. But considering the global rates, which may be true for Iran too, there are many more cases in Iran. It's curious how many cases are concentrated in some areas, but no one has conducted any pathological study to establish the underlying cause. One example is the Khuzestan province. I was born there. There is a registered population of autistic people there, which is larger than anywhere else. What's the reason? We don't know. The same goes for the northern parts of the country.
In January, it was reported 90 thalassemia patients lost their lives last year due to US sanctions and a lack of drugs. In addition, another 60 young patients have died in the current year. A Human Rights Watch report from October 2019 references a letter sent by Swedish Malinka to EB Home. That's Iran's largest NGO supporting EB patients. The UN report confirmed the company had decided not to conduct any business with Iran because of US sanctions. According to EB Home, at least 15 butterfly children had died over the last year. As for our ASD trainers, they have bitter complaints but high hopes of their own.
Our main objective is to be able to integrate autistic children into society. We don't want the children to be separated or create a facility to keep them in. As much as we believe the elderly have to be present in the society as a consultant and not be confined to nursing homes. That's why the goal is integration.
That's it for today as we take leave of our Autism Association and Friendly Network. Thanks for watching from the whole team, but do return to the box at the same times next week and each week after, as you never know what's on. Bye for now.